This is Francis Hoffman speaking with Darlene McClennan, tape two.
And we're talking about shortages of supplies. Or whether or not shortages did ever exist during the war years in hospitals.
I don't recall that there was always ample supply of blood. I'm sure that they held their own clinics. And we even had a well baby clinic for the ratings and and wives and children. I can't think offhand, especially when we once we moved into the new hospital. The old hospital, well, we had we used to have cockroaches, and we would once a week have to have a session with those. But once we moved into the new building, it was much better. I imagine they would come in the duffel bags of off ships. And
yes. What happened when a person died at the hospital? Were they... Where did they go for burial? Would they be shipped home?
Probably shipped home, I would think.
How did you learn to cope with losing patients?
Well, I think there again, I think that's built in to most nurses, whether it comes with training or whether it's something that's already there.
Do you remember the first time you, and perhaps that was even in training, was it?
Someone,
when you were young, somebody died?
Yes, I do.
Was it dreadfully hard for you to deal with?
That one was particularly hard because it was someone I knew as a child. He had led a hard life, and as so often happens, it happens at night. And I was alone on the ward. And in those days, they don't do it now, but they moved, we had what was called the silent ward. And that's where they moved someone that was going imminently going to die. And so I had to get the help of the nurse at the other end. And just before he died, he'd had an abdominal problem, and he was very toxic. And now whether it was from the release of that or not, but just as he died, he had the most beautiful smile on his face. I don't think I've ever forgotten that. And his son came later that night, and I was able to tell him about this incredible smile that, and I think it helped
yes, him, of course,
cope with it. But it, there were a lot of emotions with that, because in those days we did our own preparation before, I don't know whether nurses do that still today or not, before the undertaker took the patient.
So what does that
we
consist
had
of?
To fill the orifices. And I can remember her holding him and me doing that, and the tears were running down my cheeks. And she said, you know, what's with you? And I said, well, I knew this. I used to go for milk at his place.
Oh, I see.
When I was a little girl. And so I don't know whether nurses still have to do that or not, but we always had to prepare them. And
so you learned at a tender young age
to
cope. I'm wondering whether we have covered your wartime work. Oh, what about you came home as a bride?
We so came home to be married, and then went back. And then went back. Yes, that was exciting.
What about news that the war was actually over? I mean, where, well, do you remember
yes,
when you heard?
Yes, I do. When we went back, we rented in Clemensport, which was just about 2 miles from the base. We rented what we called a strawberry box. There were three in a row, and all naval personnel had were in them, and we had one.
What were they, though?
They were just tiny little one-bedroom bungalows.
Oh, I see. All right.
And the tide came in and out behind. And we had invited several people out to for dinner, and I remember some of them writing in the guest book, "Is the war with Germany really over?"
Oh.
And I think we had, somebody had something to drink. It was scarce to get anything to drink. We didn't drink very much, but for celebrations like that. And someone had brought some horrible tasting stuff. I think it was called Geneva Gin or something. And so we celebrated. And, of course, the riots were on in Halifax at that time, too. So it was an exciting time, and that's when we could think about, start to think about getting home and getting on with our...
With your lives.
With our lives.
Yeah. Well, when you mentioned drink, of course, Navy rum.
That's right.
Leaps to the mind.
Now,
were you, some people were issued, some
well,
Navy
I think
personnel
those
were
who were
rum.
At sea got their tot of rum. I think
I
you
see.
Had to be at sea to do that. Of course, at the wardroom there was a bar. Mm-hmm. I guess it was only, I don't ever remember it being open other than at dinner at night, and you know, in the evening, the end of a work
yeah.
day. I'm sure it wasn't open at noon. I don't remember that it was anyway.
Yes.
If it was, I didn't drink very much in those days, or these days.
When you think of all the people that you, we won't talk about your husband in this capacity, but when all the people that you worked with in the Navy, and even the patients, today, beside the man from Calgary who lost his legs that you nursed, can you think of any that were sort of inspired you in any way?
Well, I can't just think offhand. There are many people that I admired.
Mm-hmm.
All those girls, they were superior girls, mm-hmm. you know, really great girls. And of course, our matrons were an inspiration. Lots of young lads. Looking back, you'd wonder what became of them. I'm thinking too of some of the sick bay attendants that we. Mm-hmm. Work closely with, and the doctors. I've thought even recently of looking up one doctor that was on the ward around about the time I was engaged to be married and knew when I was coming home. He used to mark off on my calendar, I think I still have it, you know, every day that I was one day closer to and I've
yeah.
often wondered what happened.
Yes.
To him. And I have a picture like that of all the doctors. There was just one lady doctor at that time, Margaret mm-hmm. Alexander,
mm-hmm.
and you often hear her name mentioned in connection with things now. Must have been very unusual for her to be the only woman among so many
men. So many men, that's right.
some of those men went on, like Dr. John Keith, famous heart specialist. You know, ever so many of them. And of course, some of them lost their lives at sea, too, mm-hmm. on different ships.
Mm-hmm.
It talks specifically about two in that unlucky lady who performed a surgery on Charles Kent.
Do you think, in retrospect, that the war experience sort of made you a stronger person in any way?
Oh, I think so. I think so, like, even unconsciously. Maybe at the time you didn't realize it, but I think that you were certainly primed to sort of dedicate your whole life to helping others and thinking about others.
Mm-hmm. Where did your wedding take place?
At Erskine, at my husband's church.
Oh, I see.
Erskine United in Toronto. I didn't, my parents had moved to Georgetown while I was...
So that wasn't so very far away.
No, and yeah. I didn't know anyone.
Mm-hmm.
So it seemed to go where at least one of us was known.
So was it a uniform wedding?
He was in uniform.
Yes.
I went away in my uniform, but I did wear a white wedding gown.
Yes.
I figured there would be... And my father gave me away. And,
yes. So in all respects, it was sort of a traditional setting
and,
for the wedding.
And the nurses and gave me a shower after I got back. And the wardrobe officers presented us with this...
silver box.
Silver box.
This is nice. What does it say on it? Presented to Lieutenant and Mrs... Is it T.H.?
J.H.
Oh, J.H. Mm-hmm. McClennan. On the occasion of their wedding by the wardroom officers. What does wardroom mean?
Oh, that was our...
That's the wardroom.
The wardroom where we ate and socialized.
Yes. H.M.C.S. Cornwallis.
Probably needs shining.
What would this... is this to contain a particular thing?
Well,
or
it's a cigarette box. It
is a cigarette box, yeah.
Use it
it's really very attractive,
such,
though.
But it's a keepsake.
Yeah. Yes, yes. Yeah. Oh, that's nice. So Christie Hospital, then. Christie Street Hospital.
It was a veterans hospital, mm-hmm. and so I came, when we came home, I applied there, and of course, as I say, with the seniority that we had, there was no difficulty in getting in.
Mm-hmm.
Although they had nurses certainly that had not been in the service, but that pretty well guaranteed you a job.
Yes.
And we found a little apartment quite near the hospital,
mm-hmm.
and my husband was one of the first group that went to Ajax after the war. The engineering at U of T, it was part of it, but it was so filled that they spilled over into Ajax.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he went 2 years to Ajax. He was in electrical engineering and then graduated in 49. And I worked all the time.
Being at the Veterans Hospital, were you looking after people that were long-term care? Or did you have civilian
patients?
Well,
there were a lot of returned service personnel that, you know, had long-term wounds. And, of course, any veteran was able to go there for free treatment.
Oh, I see.
And so you'd have your usual run-of-the-mill of
regular routine. Mm-hmm. Yes. What about some of the men that had come back, say, from dreadful experiences in prisoner of war camps and needed to be nursed back to health?
Yes.
You know, did you have that type of patient as well?
I think,
do you remember?
There probably was, but I don't remember that I was on the ward. We had a lot of paraplegics, patients that were paralyzed from the, you know, sometimes the waist down, sometimes from the neck.
So would these be people that would perhaps remain there for a very, very
long term, and and they'd be fighting infection, kidney infection, constantly, and it was
Is that sort of many
injections? You know, you were forever giving them intramuscular.
When you're working in an environment like that with patients that are long term and very little hope for any improvement, I suppose, is that not dreadfully stressful for both the patient and the nursing staff?
Yes, I think I would say there was more stress being at Christie Street than there was really being in the you know, active duty. Because some of them, you knew that they, you know,
they probably
wouldn't have much of a.
They wouldn't have much, perhaps even not much will to struggle.
No.
Yes.
Some of them were able to get to Lyndhurst Lodge and get. Of course, they're improving. They were improving all the time on the appliances.
Yes. Was there much in the way of sort of physiotherapy and an attempt towards rehabilitation as we see today from injuries?
Yes, a fair bit of that. And, of course, they had did have their own physiotherapists at that time. Then.
Yes.
Would be active.
Yeah. Now, TB and that sort of thing, perhaps, I'm thinking about men in as prisoners where they were not receiving care.
Mm-hmm.
Or adequate care.
I don't remember that they had those at Christie Street. I think they were probably sent to Weston.
To the other sanatoriums.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
We would maybe get something like a tubercular hip, like where where surgery was needed, that type of thing. Surgery.
Now, was it at this time that you began to do more operating room work?
I was. You got shifted around from ward to ward, and I did it, you know, some terms in the operating room.
Mm-hmm.
There again, we had to take night duty, and I remember my husband and I used to leave each other notes because he'd be gone in the morning before I'd get off, and I'd be almost away by the time he got back. At night. It was an interesting time. He had to work hard for his degree, being out of school for that length of time.
Mm-hmm. How many children do you have?
I have one of each.
A boy and a girl.
A boy and a girl. My son is an engineer as well. He's in civil, and he took his master's at University of Waterloo in hydraulics. The water end of things.
Yes.
And my daughter is an artist. That's some of her work.
Oh.
She lives in the Ottawa Valley.
Does she?
In Ironbriar. And she's very talented.
What is your daughter's name? Is she single still, or is
she? No, she's married. She is married to her husband's name is Lamondo.
Mm-hmm.
Ken Lamondo.
So what is your daughter's name?
Margaret.
All right. Yes.
And she's quite well known in the Ottawa Valley.
Yes.
This is one of her prints, has come out in print, and this is one of her originals.
They're very, very nice.
Yes. She is very good on detail. She just finished a show in Westport, which is on the Rideau.
I know Westport very well. Yes.
And this coming weekend, she has one in Ottawa in Westboro.
Mm-hmm.
I think she has three or four out in print now.
So where did Margaret do her training?
At Queen's.
Uh-huh.
She went to Queen's and took the Bachelor of Art Education.
Oh, I see. Yes.
She taught high school art for about 5 years, and then has gone into art full time.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yes. Yes, she's good. There's no question about that. There's an article on her in the this Valley magazine, which comes just a new magazine out.
Oh, it's an Ottawa publication.
Yes, it comes down. Yeah. I think it's Eastern Ontario. It comes down as far as Perth. I'll find it here. There it is.
Oh, here we are. All right. This is Valley, spring 1991, Valley, the magazine for Eastern Ontario. And it's an article by Mary Tui.
Yes, she writes for the Ottawa Citizen.
Yeah.
And
there's a picture of your daughter in her studio.
Yes.
There. That's rather nice.
Yes.
Out with Grandpa is a lovely,
yes,
is that hers?
Now, yes, now the Grumbacher paint people in Montreal commissioned her to do the original of that one for their 60th anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
And they also bought 500 prints to give to their best customers.
Oh, that's very nice. So she's making quite a,
yes,
a mark,
for a
obviously.
For herself in the, yes, in the valley. I think someday we'll hear great things about her.
Lamando.
I can't say it myself. Lamando.
Lamando.
Mm-hmm.
Right, Marg Lamando. Oh, well, okay, then we'll all pay attention to that name now when we hear it.
Yes, you should.
Yes,
come
that's
across.
Good. Now, let's get on to your Red Cross work here in Kitchener.
Okay.
And I'm curious about when and how
I got to
this, yes.
Well, we were in the process of moving over here. My husband was going with the university as a liaison between engineering and students coming in. And he was only at the university. We had rented a house out in Petersburg. And we hadn't moved over because our son was being married in 2 weeks to a Kitchener girl. And our house in Toronto was sold, and so he was staying out at the house that we had rented while he started at the university. And he was only there 10 days when he had a cerebral hemorrhage.
Oh my.
And died very suddenly. I wasn't here, I was in Toronto. And he was found. He hadn't appeared at work, and he hadn't come home, so I called my son, who was in his final year at Waterloo in engineering, and he checked with the university, and they said he hadn't come in. And then his boss had just come back from identifying the body. So it was a very sudden thing.
Oh, yes, very dreadful.
Very traumatic because Bruce was being married in 2 weeks and Margaret was going off to Queens. So suddenly from a family of four, I was one. And it was difficult to cope.
Your husband's name was?
Bud.
Bud.
Yeah.
He was called Bud.
He was called Bud. James.
Okay. But James was his.
James was his.
Yeah. So that was a dreadful
thing
for you to
cope
with.
Yes, it really was. And the people offered to back out of buying our house in Toronto. And I said, no. I knew if I stayed there, I'd be a terrible leaner on my friends. And I thought it was in our plans to come to Waterloo. I think I'll just come on.
How brave.
And so I did.
Yeah.
And well, I knew I would really feel sorry for myself.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I didn't. I did. But anyway, I moved. I moved over before the wedding, actually, and we went on with the wedding. It was a difficult thing to do, but Pat and Joan, I went out to speak to Joan in the car. They're marvelous people, and I had a nice note from the minister, and so we just went ahead.
Yes. So at this point, you sort of had to take stock of
right. I hadn't once,
what you were going to do.
I'd never worked after Bruce was born in 49. My husband always felt that we could do without things and I'd be home when the children needed me, sort of the old school. Today the kids can't afford to do that, but anyway, I came on then to Petersburg and out in the country, and me and my dog. And so I lived out there from 71. This happened in August of 71, so it's 20 years this past month since I've been widowed. And then I thought, well, I can't sit around here, and I've got to get back with it. So I went to Manpower, and they said, well, what, you know, what do you like to do? And I said, well, I've been out of nursing a long time. I would have to take a course if I were to go into active duty nursing. Maybe that's down the line, but right at the moment I just want something to keep me busy. And they said, well, we have a job with a prestigious flower shop. What do you think about that? And I said, oh, I don't know anything about it, but I love flowers. So they said, well, why don't you go down and have an interview? And it was at Laura Sharp's in Kitchener. So I went down, and Dorothy Dick often says to me, I can see you yet coming in. You said, well, I'm a registered nurse. I really don't know what I'm doing here, but I like flowers. She said, I knew I just had to hire you. So I went to work. And it was a very soothing, I had to deal a little with people, and I learned a little bit of how to make a flower
arrangements. Yes.
And it was a nice place to work. I knew I wasn't going to stay there forever, but
it was a breathing
sort of a
space.
Yes,
and,
to give me some time. And my son and his wife, everyone just assumed that they would move in with me because I had such a big house. And I said, no, it's not right for you to start off your married life like that. And so they, one of her bridesmaids was a teacher at Cameron Heights, and she was looking for some place to board. So they suggested that she come and live with me. And it was great for that first winter because it ensured that I would make a meal. And I think it was good for me and good for her as well. So we got through that winter, and I think that June, I still went into the flower shop, and I used to have to pull over first thing in the morning and have a little cry to myself on the way in, and the same at night. And but I was coping. And an ad came in the paper for a registered nurse with a car, it said salary expected, and so I answered it. And Dorothy at this time was over in England. And so I went for the interview, and they laugh about it now too, because I had written on my resume where they said salary expected, not important. I laugh at it now, I think. Anyway, that was my, I had the interview with the supervisor, and then of course I had to go before the chairman of the board, and she said, we just had to have a look at you, and he said it wasn't important. The salary wasn't important. Anyway, that started me at Red Cross, and the supervisor at that time was Evelyn Hackney, and she and I are still friends today. She was a wonderful person.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, she and her husband would drop in on me out at where I lived, because of course I had to make all new friends.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really am very grateful to her for her support.
What were your duties immediately?
Well,
were you hired as part of the homemaker?
As assistant supervisor.
I see. Okay.
Yes.
So it was not just for the homemaker program, or was it?
Yes, it was just the homemaker program, mm-hmm. and she was supervisor of the homemaker service at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And we only had about 30 homemakers.
Mm-hmm.
And we did the training, she and I, ourselves. At the old nurse's residence at KW.
Yes.
I think the service had been going then for maybe about 6 or 7 years.
I see. So it was relatively new.
It was relatively new.
Yes.
And she, I think, had been there for 2 years when I came. And when I joined, we were in the old Dunker building in
Kitchener.
We taught these girls, you know, how to make a bed with a patient in and out, and all the routine training, how to deal with the aged, and I think that first group of homemakers had to be one of the best ever turned out.
Really?
Some of them are still with the service. Some in the early years that we trained.
Yes.
Now, of course, they go to the college for their training.
I see, yes.
Which is good, too. But, of course, it's grown to about 200 homemakers today.
There's 200 in locally?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. From, say, 30 when I started.
Yes. Yeah. So did you spend your day basically in the office organizing or how?
Assigning and organizing, and then I would visit the homemakers in the home. If we put a homemaker in a home, they would get a visit while they were there, just to mm-hmm. see that things were running smoothly, that they had no problems, that the patient or client was happy with the situation. And then we would assign daily, we'd assign the homemakers for the next day or the next week mm-hmm. as to where they'd be going.
So
between visiting and assigning, you had a full day.
Yeah. What year is this?
I think, yeah, I started in June of 72.
72, yes, okay.
And and so I was with them about 14 and a half years.
Yeah. And how did you select the people that were to receive the benefits of this program?
You mean the clients that were ill?
Yes, that yes. Was, I mean, how was that sorted out?
Well, that was done really... for the most part, for us through the home care. Well, the home care program came in while I was there, but we'd get the referrals from the doctors.
Oh, I see.
People coming home from hospital
yes.
would need a homemaker. They'd come home early, mm-hmm. and they would have. And then the home care program was operating, so that we would get. Through them, through their coordinator in the hospital,
mm-hmm.
would set. Things up would phone and say, you know, we need a homemaker here, and then we would do the assigning from that.
Mm-hmm.
Full days, they'd do full days or 4 hours, or now I understand they do two and then even in some cases 1 hour.
Oh, do they?
Yes.
So it would be just popping in to do whatever
yes.
is necessary,
yes.
and then yes, yeah. Were these women paid very much for
very
doing this?
Poorly
were
paid,
they?
I
yes.
should say, but it was what you know, Red Cross didn't have all that much money in those days. In fact, my salary wasn't very big either.
So let's just talk about the budget for a wee bit, because I suppose that they work in strains.
I think they probably worked for $2 an hour would be would have been top pay.
Yes. Yeah.
Because I know that for quite a few years I got $5,000 a year.
Mm. Which in the early 70s wasn't a fantastic amount, was it?
No, it wasn't. But it was what they could afford.
Yes.
And fortunately I had a little other income as well.
Who decided upon how much money would be channeled into the homemaker program? Was it the board?
That would have been done by the board and the Red Cross allotment as a whole. The Red Cross board, I would think.
Yes.
Would assign.
So the program expanded whilst you were there considerably.
Yes, it grew, we were well over 100.
So how did this come about? I mean, was there increased monies available to you in order to expand, or how did you make it grow?
Yes, well, I think the home care program itself grew, and the need for more and more.
So the doctors perhaps were
more
making known that this was,
that this was
working
available.
And they wanted to use it.
And more and more people, if they couldn't afford it, there was a program of coverage for them.
So some clients
they were covered under what was called the Homemakers and Nurses Service Act, HNSA.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's how that would...
So did you always become aware that a family were in need of help through a doctor's referral?
And they could also, as long as they had their doctor's permission, have one privately if they could afford to pay for it.
I see. Yes. Yeah. Did you ever go into a home to sort of do some sort of assessment as to see what this family needed?
Yes. Yes, we did that. Yeah.
Was that part of your job or...?
Yes, and also the home care would send their coordinator in to assess what the need, if they needed a physio or a nurse or a homemaker. And it was paid for under the Homemakers and Nurses Service Act. The homemaker would be paid for as long as a nurse or physio or speech therapist was going in as well.
Mm-hmm.
There was a certain number of hours available. I think at the beginning it was 80. It was divided into acute home care and later on chronic home care came in so that you wouldn't necessarily, you could get longer, say two or three times a week or once a week for a longer period of time.
Mm-hmm.
If for instance, if I were not able to cope here on my own, there's no one else to help. If I were eligible, I could go on that chronic.
So were many of the people that required this help elderly?
A lot were elderly.
I see.
A lot were elderly, yes.
And that is actually a...
The majority, I'd say.
It's a way of keeping people in their
today.
Own home.
That's right. They're much happier.
And, yes.
There isn't the drain on the nursing homes.
Yeah, that's right. I wonder whether there was ever times when you simply didn't have enough personnel available to cope with all the needs throughout the community. I mean,
Yes, I'm sure that there were times that
that would create headaches for you if you were
constantly having to hire more people.
Where did you find the women? I mean, what attributes were you looking for?
Well, a caring, you know, a real caring person. Preferably someone who had raised a family of their own. That's the ideal one.
Yes.
So they would be skilled in the basic homemaker qualities. Mm-hmm. And then after that, the caring personality to mm-hmm. come through. Some of those women are beautiful women.
Mm-hmm. You said earlier that some of them had done it for many, many years.
Yes.
I wonder what the typical span of length
well,
of employment
I
might be.
Still go to their dinners where they hand out the service pins, and there's some of them that are up to 20 years of service.
I hope they're receiving 15. More than $2 an hour.
Yes,
now.
the pay is still not great.
No,
in our terms, but certainly much better. I don't know. I think they probably make around eight something an hour tops now. I'm not in on the.
But they must be finding the work rewarding to be doing it for so long.
You have to have
because
that
if you're not earning big dollars, then
yes,
yeah,
you have to be caring to stay with it that
yes.
length of time. You certainly do.
Yeah,
yeah.
So what would a typical day be for you? I mean, if you went in what nine to four, 9 to 5,
I was
or something?
Always there before. Sometimes 8:30. Of course, the phone rings constantly, and then you'd be making your rounds, setting out who you were going to visit, because you not only had just Kitchener Waterloo, you had the surrounding.
Oh, you had the
area,
townships
like
as well.
Elmira, yes, the region of Waterloo.
Okay. Yeah.
So you'd go maybe to New Hamburg one day and.
You would you sort of be doing that to inspect that these people were getting the required
that they were doing
assistance
their job?
They needed.
Yes.
I see.
And that the needs of the homemaker herself were mm-hmm. were being met.
Excuse me. What sort of equipment did you supply these women with? I mean, did they take their own cleaning things if they had to do cleaning? Or
no, although occasionally we would maybe have to go out and get them something. This was in the early days. But they wore a uniform.
What was it like?
It was a blue dress with an apron. In the early days, they wore caps.
Mm-hmm. Like the old-fashioned nurse's
like
cap.
Like the old-fashioned mm-hmm. nurse's cap. And I must say, they did look neat. They don't wear that today. We did away with them eventually. We used to claim that it kept them from doing things that they shouldn't be doing, such as cleaning ovens and so on. But now today, the stuff you have to clean your oven, it's not like the old days.
No, it's not quite the same, no. but still,
that's probably.
Yeah, what would be the range of responsibilities that you would expect the homemaker to assume
doing?
When they're, yeah.
They'd do the laundry and the vacuuming and the dusting, prepare meal preparation, shopping, they would go shopping. Just pretty well jack of, you know, anything.
And then
that
be a shoulder to cry on, I suppose.
That's right.
If necessary.
Now for the longest time, the nurse would come in and give the bath, but I believe now the homemakers are doing that themselves.
Yes. So, apart from sitting in your, I shouldn't say sitting, but working in your office, scheduling, etc., and doing inspections out. Were there other aspects of responsibility
well, it was
that you had?
The paperwork was constant, and then
yes.
there would be meetings to attend. Like we would work closely with Family and Children's Services, a lot of the other organizations, a meeting at home care. Mm. Different meetings along that line mm-hmm. with the VON, and so your day was full. There wasn't time to
To sit with your feet up.
To find time on your hands at all.
Yes, yeah. Well, besides, well, the training program that you were constantly training new women, I suppose, mm-hmm. were you, to do this work?
In the early years,
we'd set
up maybe a 2-week period.
Oh, I see.
And it would be an intensive training.
So, would you advertise that this was going to take place to get recruits?
We would have already hired the girls.
Oh, I see. All right.
And then they would take that. They would take the course.
I see. And that would be, you said, bath. Well, care for the elderly and making beds and. The general run-of-the-mill things. When did you decide to resign or retire?
From
Red Cross.
When I became 65.
I see. So it was.
I had the option to stay on for a while longer, but I just felt that it was time to maybe sort of start doing other.
I see. And the program had expanded incredibly.
Much, yes.
From 30 to 200, did you say, or something?
Yes. My immediate supervisor had retired 2 years before. And I had been offered the position, but I just felt that I was going to leave within a short time.
So had they started using computers?
I think they had started.
Was that just coming
so
in? And
the assigning had just started mostly in the office when I left.
Mm-hmm.
But I would imagine they'll be assigning by computer before long. And of course, the supervisory staff has grown to about 8 full-time supervisors and well over 200 homemakers, and I'm not sure how many are in the office staff, but it has really grown.
Yeah. Do you think helping the expansion come about was sort of your chief accomplishment while there?
Yes, I would say so. Mm-hmm. Change. You're always reticent to change. You are, and especially as you're growing older, you think, you know, the old ways were best.
Yes.
But I can see that you can't stand still. You have to.
Yes.
The progress has to.
That's right.
Come along.
Yeah.
I miss the girls. We had a good relationship, and I see them occasionally now on a social basis. Evelyn Hackney and I sort of. They had the 25th anniversary last year, I think it was, of the Homemaker Service. And she and I compiled a book. It would be interesting for you to see it
sometime. Oh, yes, it would.
Because there are a lot of clippings.
So it's
that would
a, what
help
is it,
you
a
better
scrapbook?
Understand. It's a scrapbook. Would help you better understand the whole movement.
Yeah. Where is this scrapbook kept?
It would be at Red Cross.
I see.
It would
All
be,
right.
You could ask in the Homemaker Service.
Yes.
Because it's an interesting history.
Mm-hmm.
It really is.
Mm-hmm.
And marvelous service. And certainly all credit to the girls that go out and do the
That's
job.
Right, yeah. You sort of think about, I suppose in the old days it was family that looked after others when they needed the help. But today, I suppose, with the changes in our family life, and
both people working.
That's right. So it therefore falls the responsibility of society at large assume this responsibility. Yeah. So it's a whole change, isn't it,
in
the way we do things. Yeah. Well, what about volunteerism? I mean, as a general thing, do you feel that it's still healthy?
Oh, yes, I do. There are ever so many things where one can get involved and I think should stay involved.
Mm-hmm. Are there ever difficulties, though, just finding the bodies to do these things?
Oh, I'm sure. The more and more now, But I think it's a good way to keep yourself active and keep sort of feeling sorry for yourself. There's no need to sit around. There's so much that one mm-hmm. can do there. They always need, ever so many of these associations need help.
I think, though, that perhaps the idea of a person being compassionate, I wonder, because you have worked in so many capacities now, how do you ensure that people will develop a compassionate attitude towards others? I wonder if our society is becoming more or less benevolent. It's hard to determine in many instances, and I wonder if you have any sort of secrets or tips. I mean, is it our young people that we have to try and instill these things in?
Well, I think so. I think it needs to start at an early age. Like, I look at my own granddaughter, for instance, and see that how she's helping in a capacity. This year she was a junior counselor at a camp that she had been attending. She has been a candy striper helping mm-hmm. out.
Yes.
I think by and large that the young people are mm-hmm. Helping out more, are aware that there's a need out there.
Who took over your position when you left? Do you remember?
No, I don't. I think they took on several new supervisors at that time.
You've been involved in church activities a fair amount, haven't you?
Yes, I've been an elder off and on, I think, for 9 years, and then I've had just a year ago had a year off, and I'm back again now.
Which church do you belong to now?
Emmanuel United.
Yes.
So I've helped out in various capacities mm-hmm. there. I probably could do more. But I'm over at Parkwood Manor on Tuesdays. I help the hairdresser there go and get the patients in their wheelchairs, and I enjoy that.
Mm-hmm.
I guess since I'm getting older, I relate to the older people more.
Yeah.
But there are some pets there.
Yes.
And it doesn't faze me if I have to take them to the toity and
that's right.
take their diety off and so on.
Yes. Tell me, though, I'm interested in your church activity, because it seems to me that over the last few years that women's role within the church has been evolving. And women have been, not just in the ministry itself, but as lay people, mm-hmm. women mm-hmm. are having a more, they're determining more things than they used
more
to do.
A role to play.
And I wonder whether within your own church perhaps that's been evident to you, or whether you've even helped formulate some of these changes.
I'm not active in the women's group per mm-hmm. se, but certainly there's an active group there. I'll help out in various capacities of short-term things if they need some help.
Mm.
But yes, I think women are playing a greater part in church affairs now. We've had women clerk of sessions for quite a few years now, and our assistant minister is a woman, very good one mm-hmm. too. I think not only in the United Church but other churches as well, women
yes.
are playing a bigger role.
Yes,
which is good.
Yeah. When did you retire? Was it 1986?
1986.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And there was an article in the newspaper. Was it August of 1986? Let me find the date here. August 27, 1986,
yes.
in the KW Record, was it? Or in the Waterloo Chronicle?
It was in the Chronicle.
Waterloo Chronicle, that's right, yes. And it talks a little bit about your hobbies.
Yes.
And trekking was one thing that was high on the list.
Well, yeah. I think I had just returned from a trip to Nepal, and I had been trekking in the mountains with my grandchildren, and that's what brought on those comments.
Yes.
I do like to walk, and so my visit there sort of inspired that.
Yeah, yeah. When you were in Nepal, mm-hmm. because of being a nurse, of course, I suppose it's in your blood that you sort of look around for ways of improving things. But were there ever times when you were able to help anybody?
I did on one occasion. My daughter-in-law volunteered at a clinic downtown, so she took me with her, and I spent the day working in the clinic along with the Nepali doctors. A lot of it, we were dispensing medicines. They would bring in their bottle to be filled. The Nepalis don't have the live in the out in the country well, and in Kathmandu, parts of it haven't. They have indoor fireplaces, so that they have terrible chest conditions from smoke, and they're forever using dispensing cough medicines, and I think there's a lot of respiratory problems with the resulting smoke.
That's rather surprising, really. Mm-hmm. We think of that part of the world as being such a healthy
and a lot of them
way of life.
And
oh, do
themselves.
They? Yes, yes. So how was smoke. Your day? Did you
Great.
Find it fascinating?
Fascinating, yeah.
Yes.
It really was. Yes. It was. I had some great experiences there. I went another day out into the countryside to visit a community that where there was an American couple visiting their foster child for the first time.
Mm.
And I went through the ritual of putting the red tiki dot on your forehead and blessing. And you know, it was a real warm religious feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Sitting there around on the dirt floor with that couple and the little foster child, mm-hmm. and the parents and brothers and sisters. And they had shared with us a boiled egg, and it looked like social tea biscuit. And they probably only saw a boiled egg once every 2 weeks, but this was a real thing for them to share this with us.
So one egg?
one egg.
Between six
there
people
were two
or
eggs.
Something?
Oh, there were, but they, of course, didn't have any.
Oh, I see.
We were being honored.
I see,
this.
Yes.
And I was a little reticent. I sort of dug in to get the yolk because diarrhea is very common over there. The favorite story everywhere I went, my son's friends would be, "Have you been sick yet?"
I see.
Drinking the water and
yes.
Everything had to be boiled. They had their water purified, and so you took great chance. And they passed this cup around for us to. I think it was Nepali beer or wine. I'm not sure which, but to drink from a common cup, you're really asking for trouble.
So how does one avoid and not give offense?
Well, you just go through
the
motions and mm-hmm. cross your fingers and hope that you aren't.
I'm surprised to hear about the water because one thinks of, you know, pure crystal mountain
coming
springs
from the mountains.
And so on, but
no, it's no. I know Carol washed her greens, even the greens that grew in their own yard, in a solution of iodine.
Oh my!
Yes, and they never.
What is
drank.
Causing this? Why is it so?
Well, I think pollution. Of course, the hygiene is terrible in. I mean, they just go anywhere,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
in the countryside, mm-hmm. and in Kathmandu as well.
Yeah,
they don't have them, and strangely enough, they don't seem. I mean, they're trying to remedy this, but they don't seem to want it. They like the old ways. It's interesting.
So it was a whole new world for you, wasn't it?
Yes, surely was.
Yes.
Yeah.
Good. I think probably we'll finish here.
Oh, okay.
And
fine.
I'd like to say thank you very, very much for doing this.
Great. I hope
it's good.
Helped some.